Oh. It is us between you and shipping, I think it said on the agenda. So it's tough to compete with free shipping, but we're going to try. With all seriousness, it's actually a really exciting topic. Customer engagement. You know, I spent a lot of my years on the publisher side and working with many of you in this room, and have recently, over the last couple of years, went over to the brand side and worked at JPMorgan Chase. And consumer engagement is probably our number one topic that we talk about every single day. And I know you're going to get three really great presentations to talk about it. I want to start by telling you a little bit about my role, and I want to hopefully leave you with some thoughts and get you thinking, because we're going to try to have a little interactive session at the end. In my title, it says that I run digital marketing, but I want to make a very specific statement that I am a marketer, not a digital marketer. I spend my time talking to my products and brand groups every day about integrated programs. My consumers spend their time both online, which they spend a lot of time. 84% of all of Chase consumers' transactions happen digitally, which is a pretty great stat for me, and I use that a lot with my businesses. But we still have an offline business with our branches. My point to all of you is that we are marketers, and we have to leverage these technologies in the best customer experience. One of the things that I tell our brand owners every day is that we need to be useful, thoughtful, and relevant in every experience that we do. And I think that's the art of great marketing, not just great digital marketing. So we have three great presentations coming up here. Why don't we kick it off with our first, with Aaron from Spotify, and let's get busy.
Brian and Aaron.
I got it.
Cool. So thank you. And for those of you who can't see, I actually used to work at a bank many, many years ago, but those shoes were not allowed at a bank, and big hand for the toes.
Come on, Aaron.
I love it, Robert. I love it.
Anyways,
thanks so much for having us. I'm Aaron Clift. I work at Spotify. I couldn't be happier to represent music at iMedia. It's a pretty cool position to be in. I'm even more excited to have with me Brian Johnston from the UFC. I'm not yet a huge fan of Ultimate Fighting Champions, but I'm going to be, because I just committed to my first event. I'm going to go to in Montreal, hopefully. But I have been a very long-time fan of the work that Brian does at the UFC and how they use music and marketing to really grow their consumer base. So I'm excited for him to tell his story. And I'm going to apologize. I'm going to try not to keel over on stage. Oh, thanks. I'm not even sure it will help, but I'm going to keep going with that. So
I'll be your assistant.
You'll be my assistant? I love that. Anyway, so thanks for having us. I'm going to kick it off with this quote. I happen to love it. It's new. Music is like a universal language. You have to speak the same language, so it's kind of the glue that holds the earth together in some way or another. I can't remember a time when it wasn't there, so if it wasn't there, I don't know what I'd do. I love that quote. We just did a bunch of focus groups around the country, and that's where this comes from over the summer. This one actually comes from Chicago, my Chicago friends. And I love it, and I think it speaks volumes to how important music is in people's lives and does a much better job than I could do of explaining that to you. Music is a massive deal for people. It's a form of personal expression. It motivates. It connects us to the people we love and to the moments that are most important for us throughout our lives. So when you think about, you know, all of the how and why that we listen, you start to see all these musical moments that make up a person's life. Until now, there really hasn't been a way to connect music with those moments in a consistent way. So, you know, how do we actually fulfill that sort of dynamic and ever-present role that music plays in our lives? So at Spotify, we believe it starts with your music platform. And I think platform is a really loaded word. My guess is you've heard it a lot during your time here and in other conferences. So I'm going to explain what a platform means to Spotify. So the first phase of our platform really is about access. So the first thing we did was we created a way that people can access all of their favorite music in the same place in a way that's free, simple, fast, and legal, which is a really big deal and something that hadn't been done to date. Now we offer 18 million tracks around the globe and 20,000 or more added every day. It's pretty cool. The second phase of our platform really is about, now that you have access to all this music, what do you do with it? You know, I think that whether it's a lean-back radio experience like Pandora or a, you know, a crowdsourced DJ experience like Turntable FM, there's lots of ways that we like to experience music. Creating a platform where people can build on top of the music means that they can create applications to meet all of your needs and all of your family and friends' needs and all the ways that you like to experience music. Sorry. It's not cool. So the last piece of the platform is really about making sure that those experiences can live everywhere. So whether it's you're inside of Spotify, on your own websites, on social networks such as Facebook, and across every device, it's really important these days that we can actually make music ubiquitous and all the experiences that you can create with music all around. So we think the platform is a really big idea, and I think having, you know, a music platform means that, again, you can sort of build all those experiences so you can be there at the right time for every experience that you want to have. But let's take a look at what that actually means. There's so many screens, I'm not really sure what order, to be honest, forever. So at the end of last year, we actually, for the first time, launched the Spotify platform. We opened up our platform for third-party developers to actually build different experiences, connecting Spotify's API with APIs from other social, geo, music products across the web. A really interesting way to create new ways that people can play, discover, and share music. So publishers, labels, brands, all creating, all have a unique perspective on what types of things they want to do for consumers, and now they can do it. They've built a really interesting app base for us so far. So now you can use TuneWiki, and you can sing along to literally any song on our service. You can listen to Art Garfunkel when you're reading the review on the Rolling Times of his new album. Or my favorite one, which is Filter, which actually uses Facebook's Open Graph to mash up your music taste with your friend's music taste across the web so you can start creating common playlists that you can listen to together. So, you know, when you think about the idea that now you have the ability to access music through the platform and you can create all these different things, the opportunities are literally endless. And the response has been pretty incredible. Over 2,700 years worth of time has been spent on our app since launch. And I believe we're just getting started. Most of our app experience actually lives inside of the service, so let's take a look at what happens again when you sort of take the experiences across the web. Spotify's always had an open API, which means that we've always made it possible for you to integrate some of our functionality into your sites and into your experiences. A few months ago, we launched a Spotify play button, making that really, really easy. So now publishers, Yahoo, The Huffington Post, People, Glamour, Tumblr, and thousands of others can easily marry music to their editorial experiences or integrate Spotify in a way through a super, very simple widget and piece of code into their own sites and things that they're building for their consumers, making it more engaging. This is actually one that I happen to love. It's a new one with the election, very relevant. But the Huffington Post is essentially Spotify in the election, and they're curating playlists for the Democratic, Republican, and independent states across the US, which I think is a really interesting way to marry sort of two things that people tend to be super passionate about, music and politics. So you provide access to the music as the first piece of a platform. You make it easy for people to build on top of it. And so then what is next is social. There's really nothing more social than music. Over half of everything that happens across social networks is music related in one way or another. So it's really important for us to not only build social into our platform, but to also plug, you know, other networks in, together with ours, which is what we did about a year ago when we integrated with Facebook. It was a really big milestone and very important because it was the first time that we really fueled the discovery and sharing of music outside of Spotify. And it's actually working quite well. In a given month, about 1.5 billion times, someone takes an action on Spotify into Facebook. So it could be sharing a song, creating a playlist, or so on and so forth. And it's really, really important, and which is why I always like to say that, you know, social strategies are so important these days. I'm sure you guys have talked about it a lot over the past day or so, and I don't believe that you can have a social strategy today without really thinking about your music strategy. So what does this all mean for brands and people like yourselves? I don't have to tell you that, you know, brands and music have a very long, rich history together. There's been, you know, brands like Coca-Cola who, you know, you can think of 1,000 different ways that they've worked with music. But historically, it's been really hard to actually use music as an evergreen part of your marketing strategy for a variety of reasons. And with the platform, we've tried to make it a much more simple. So we've created a pretty rich toolkit that allows you to not only just, you know, very easily reach a large and engaged audience, but allows you to also build experiences that match your brand, that match your objectives, and that allow you to actually build a different type of relationship with your consumer that can live on your sites, in your social strategies, inside of Spotify, or wherever you want them to. There have been so many really cool examples of things that brands have done since I've been at Spotify, which has been about a year. It was kind of hard to choose one, so I chose the most recent one, which is something Converse did to share with you before I turn it over to Brian. You know, just like people really identify themselves with the music they listen to, they certainly also do it with the clothes that they wear, and particularly their shoes. So you can take a look at what Converse did.
Hey, Spotify users, let's talk. Because that's what humans do. Every day, people make choices about who they are. Some people just want to fit in. Others choose to resist conformity and express their true self. It's a shoes versus sneakers decision. Shoes like a path. Sneakers make trails. Shoes scuff. Sneakers dent. So, who are you, a shoe or a sneaker? Tell us for a custom playlist.
So it's really simple. I mean, all Converse did was activate the platform the way that it was meant to be, which was, you know, ask users to, you know, answer three questions about whether they were a shoe or a sneaker. Obviously, Converse users are sneaker users, and they curated a bunch of really great playlists that now all the people who answered that, it went viral on Facebook, it created stories, it lives on the left side. You know, Converse playlists now live within Spotify. And it was a really cool way for them to use music to get a little bit closer to their consumers. So like I said, there's a ton of ways to do this. I wanted to stop and let Brian actually share what the UFC did. So I'm gonna turn it over to Brian and come back in a sec. Take it away.
Thanks for having me. So if you know anything about sports and you know anything about entertainment and you know anything about the brands that we all care about, music, you just can't pull it apart from the brand. It becomes, we talked about it earlier when we were having lunch, you think of your favorite brand, you might not like the same genre of music, but you can associate music with every brand. For us in the UFC, it's integrated into our broadcasts, it's integrated into pay-per-views, but probably the most significant part is it's integrated into our fighters' lives. So whether you know anything about the UFC or not, basically what happens is these guys have 90 days to get ready for a fight. So they build soundtracks, they're played in their gyms, they're played on whatever music device they have, and this becomes incredibly personal to them. So you can't really pull music away from our fighters. So the reason I showed this Cranberries piece is that song was, I think we figured out, came out in 1994. Pretty interesting, great song, not really probably relevant in the year 2012. The kid who was fighting, his nickname is the Korean Zombie. The UFC broadcasts in 142 countries, 800 million homes around the world. That song trended not only in the US, but it was the number one trending topic in Brazil for basically about 2 weeks. Our ability to reach into that community and get music out there is because of our relationship with Globo, and so when we broadcast down there, it's about 44 million homes tune in. So with our relationship with Spotify, with Facebook, we have an incredible ability to get music out there. The beauty of it is, it's not us, it's our fans. So our fans are socially engaged. We've got a footprint of probably 13 to 14 million people, about 10 million people on Facebook, 3 million people on Twitter, all great numbers. But the beauty of our fans, they talk to each other every single day. Anytime that we start working with a new platform, I'll get to Spotify in a minute, whether it's Pinterest, Instagram, You know, we've got whole collectives on Pinterest of people baking octagon cakes the night of a UFC fight. And the numbers that we throw out there, it's really crazy. Something that we didn't expect. So what we did specifically with Spotify and the UFC, Andy and Kristen out there got together, and we said, how do we organically integrate music into our fights? Well, it's really easy. We have a TV show called The Ultimate Fighter. It's the longest running reality show on cable TV. We're in our 16th season. Music is part of every fighter's lives, as I said. It's part of their walkout. So there's 32 guys that start the season, goes through a whole pyramid, there's a champion. About three quarters of the way through, we had 11 fighters left. Every fighter picked two songs. Click through these real quick. The amazing thing is, over a 72-hour period, we had 70,000 people come to the website. 40,000 people voted. Now, when I say they voted, it wasn't like they clicked on it for basically a minute or 2 minutes. You had to literally go through and listen to a 15 to 20-second clip of basically six or seven or eight of these fighters. There was little ways around it, but obviously we managed it and monitored it. But it just gives you the idea of how quickly we can bring music right into somebody's living room. And Spotify helped us do it. Probably our biggest thing that I think we all got excited about was, you know, through this execution, probably for the first time in sports, we've tried to actually figure it out. We actually let the fans pick the music, which a lot of sports leagues and brands are starting to do, but we actually put it in a broadcast. We don't have any slides on it, but after this, you know, again, our social graph completely blew up. So we love the folks at Spotify, and we're looking at the next couple of years.
Cool. Thanks, Brian. I mean, we're huge fans of the UFC and what they've done. I think it's a great, very natural, you know, organic way to integrate music. And that's really it for us. Just quick three takeaways. You know, one is, you know, again, people have a really emotional connection with music. I'm sure you all do as well. And, you know, now you have the chance to really tap into that on an evergreen basis. You can't have a social strategy without thinking about your music strategy. They go hand in hand, and I guess you could have it, but you're missing out on an opportunity to really amplify what you're trying to do. And lastly, you know, I think that the UFC does a great job of this, is there's lots of ways that you can build meaningful experiences now that leverage music. But think about, you know, everything that you're doing across your campaigns. It's not just about listening. It's about getting your users to take action, like Converse did by answering the questions, like the UFC did by getting them to actually sort of choose the direction of what something might happen. So thanks again for having us, and I'll turn it back over.
Great, thank you. Thank you. Really appreciate it. That was excellent. Leave that up there. How many people are on Spotify? Look at that group. That's a big shout out. That's great. What do you guys think of Spotify linked to your ATM account when you pull money out? You got some music? That's, never mind. All right, we'll get back to that later. But those are good ideas to think about for all your brands. All right, our next company is Social Vibe, and John and Turner, I believe. Pat from Turner. Patty, welcome. Come on up. Clicker is right there.
All
Thank
right.
you.
Come on over. I am John Capano from Social Vibe. I'm the CMO. I joined about 3 months ago, and we're going to start with some introductions. I was going to start by singing a song, but I'm glad we covered off the music because I'm not really good on the tune place, but I do know social. So a little bit about Social Vibe is basically we are a network like other networks, but we're really built for this presentation and we're built around engagement. So basically we took the three elements of any network. We took our publisher partners, we took our ad unit, and we took our placement, and we thought about it over the last 5 years, what would create the most engagement? Because we believe that engagement is what leads to brand loyalty. So we partner with publishers that are all around the channels that consumers have for passion points. So we have social, which is today's theme, but we also have music and video, we have travel, we have other publishers, and when we go to a partner, we don't necessarily go for scale the way a lot of networks do. We really go around deep engagement. We then decided to use an ad unit, or an engagement unit as we call it, that's really rich media oriented. It's got display pricing, but it gives you the creativity, full flexibility and creativity of a full rich media ad unit. And then finally, our placements. Our placements are often around the idea of consumer opt-in, such as value exchange and other placements. But when you add all that up, you really get attention from consumers and you get engagement consumers. So you're going to see how that has affected many of our clients and benefited, and also Patty's going to talk a little bit about how that's driven the numbers and results for Turner. So I'm going to turn it over to Patty Everett from Turner and TMG, and she's going to take you through a little bit about our campaign, and then I'll talk a little bit more about Social Vibe at the end.
Great. Thank you very much. So quickly about Turner and my role as it plays in, I'm head of kind of digital planning across the various Turner networks in the portfolio that they have, news, young adult animation, sports, entertainment. And Turner's kind of brand promise is, you know, fairly simple and straightforward, to share stories with the world. However, probably not quite so simple, and we know everybody loves a good story, but they really want to position themselves to lead kind of in a really, really engaging and more kind of connected media environment. So, you know, with that, kind of we're tasked at Turner Media Group to really kind of deliver and identify kind of what those new emerging platforms are, you know, what are those potential media opportunities that really kind of allow us to bring our brand message forward to the audiences, you know, so, you know, that means, you know, being nimble, really evolving our media planning, you know, with the ultimate goal of really trying to develop the most effective and innovative ways to kind of bring those audiences to the great stories that Turner creates. Because that's really what we care about at the end of the day. You know, we want people tuning in to our stories. And we feel like, you know, Turner creates wonderful stories across our portfolio. So, you know, our goal is to really kind of, you know, bring that message out, kind of build the awareness around the shows, you know, really kind of start building that social community with the fans, you know, recruiting the new viewers, encourage sampling. Hopefully that leads to intent to tune in. And, you know, what we find is that in our campaigns, we typically end up using a combination of kind of really high-reach, impactful placements. Those typically end up running day of premiere, really kind of have that point of decision-making that day of before they tune in at night. Video placements are also pretty crucial in terms of those sampling opportunities. First to market, we're really fortunate. Our marketing partners are fairly open and willing to test new opportunities, so we kind of explore first to market or close to it as we can. And then custom integrations and editorial, you know, places like a social vibe, social platforms, you know, where can we interject our messaging in front of the consumer and really get that engagement with the stories. And then, you know, the metrics, fairly standard, you know, obviously what the impressions delivered, getting that awareness out, the clicks, interactions broadly being, you know, interacting with a poll or a survey. We do a lot of custom quests and games, especially in the kids' space, so interacting with that. And then, of course, video views.
So I'll talk a little bit about when Turner came to us and they kind of presented that challenge to us. They said, really, the objective here and the goal here is to get people to tune in to increase lift. We want people to sample our shows, whether we're launching a new show or we're coming back into a season, and we'll show you a little bit about how we did that. But it's more than just sampling. It wasn't just, you know, pre-roll, get it out there and mass reach. It was really about, well, they're sampling, actually get them involved, and the Social Vibe platform is really good at doing that. As you know, or you may know if you've worked with us, we're a full service agency partner. We have a creative and strategy team that works with your creative and strategy team. We deliver that as part of the buy. We have that scalability of display. We reach over 101 million unique users across the US. But we also have that creative flexibility of new rich media, and you'll see that in the units that we've done with Turner. Again, as I said, low and no production costs. We do that work. It's part of your buy. The KPI flexibility is extremely important. For Turner, that meant we want people to view. We want video views, but we also want engagement, and we want intent to watch lifted, and we'll show you how we did that. And then also some sampling, some opt-in, and click-throughs to site and Facebook, and we'll show you a little bit about that. And of course, like any network, we've got full reporting and analytics. But it adds up to a very compelling offer and a very engaging experience for the consumer. Over the last year and a half, we've actually worked on four different campaigns, as you can see here. We helped launch The Closer. We helped launch a season of The Closer and a new season of Rizzoli and Isles. We did a big campaign with Dr. Drew. And then the campaign we're going to talk about today, which is The Great Escape, was the most recent one. And we're going to go a little deeper into that. But if you can start to see some of the metrics and the KPIs here about completion rate on the engagement, how much time users spend with these engagements, 35 seconds on the closer, 20 second on Rizzoli and Isles, and then click-through as well. You can kind of see kind of industry-leading results on click-throughs, 43%, 30%. And ultimately, the key KPI that Patty was looking for and Turner was looking for was that intent to watch. They have shows coming out, they have new seasons coming in, they want to remind people that those shows are coming back, and they want them tuning in. So that's really what we designed here, and we'll show you a little bit more about The Great Escape. Patty will tell you a little bit about what they were looking for in this particular campaign.
So just out of curiosity, anybody's watched the show? And you guys can be honest, and not on my account, okay. So for us in particular as it pertains to Social Vibe, so the mission here was to build awareness and encourage sampling. This was TNT's first foray into competition reality show. So that in and of itself kind of presented the first obstacle. It's a brand new genre to this network. Research told us that the audience that typically watches action, comedy, competition reality shows tend to be younger, more dual male-female audience that doesn't really necessarily align with the traditional TNT viewer, which is heavily female, a little bit older. So definitely needed to go off channel to kind of recruit new viewers for the show. And of course, second kind of key challenge, since there's no reality TV show going on right now on TV, you know, there's of course market saturation, there's a whole host of reality TV shows going on. So, you know, how do we kind of help The Great Escape stand out and kind of stake that claim in this really cluttered landscape? You know, they certainly brought no equity going in. It was a brand new show. You know, really try to leverage the fact that the two of the executive producers, Ron Howard and Brian Grazer of The Amazing Race, kind of bringing that in and hopefully kind of elevate that a little bit for us going into this, communicating out to the audience. And then kind of our plan of escape for this particularly for Social Vibe was, you know, finding, engaging the viewers in this social casual gaming environment. You know, that obviously we're seeing the growth in this, and that's certainly a passion point. That's probably where people go to escape and kind of out of reality and kind of play their games. So we want to kind of interject this experience in there and, you know, hopefully entertain and bring in some, you know, relevant content to them. And then having this platform giving us this opportunity to do some online sampling as well and get people interested in the show. So in terms of the campaign placement, primarily most of the campaign ran within the social gaming environment. There were a couple other channels that we tested, some music streaming and some Wi-Fi. Those are for some optimizations, but the core of the experience lived within social gaming. So you'll see here, on the bottom ad unit is kind of the trigger point. So in this case, in Cityville, you'd get 3 free city cash as a social currency value exchange in exchange for tuning into a brand message being presented by TNT. So when a user clicks, then it triggers and this experience launches, and you can see it's a very big canvas, this beautiful kind of rich ad unit. John explained, you know, there's a creative, and then you've got a video in the top right-hand corner, and then in this execution, we utilized 2 poll questions. We've done this before in a couple other campaigns and saw some really good success and some engagement. So we did this here again, and both of the questions content-related, so you'll see we're gonna walk through kind of a video that kind of brings the engagement to action, and you'll see how it relates back to the show and kind of bringing people into like, to that experience.
They're extreme places of mystery, danger, and hidden secrets. Now, TNT Sundays.
So the first question,
the Great Escape begins.
Go, 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 go. And people can see how other people voted.
3 abandoned teams, 1 goal, get out.
And then the second question was, who would you choose as your partner?
Of the Amazing Race, The Great Escape. All new Sundays at 10 after an all new Falling Skies, only on TNT.
So of course we'd have to tune in, and then once the user kind of engages in that experience, then they have an opportunity to share that out via Facebook, via Twitter. You know, hopefully those stories are populating and getting their friends, you know, interested in kind of having that kind of natural organic amplification at the end of that. See there? Great. So we can just go ahead, so you guys can get the gist, kind of walk through the flow. So that's generally what the user flow looks like. And then, so you'll see, and John kind of, you know, we're seeing consistently kind of as the campaigns that we're doing with Social Vibe, just some incredibly really strong results. I mean, really high completion rates. The time spent, in this case, there was a video and a poll, 2 questions, so 45 seconds, you know, really high clicks to the site. And then there was a brand study done in the end, so, you know, really high lift and intent to watch, which is ultimately kind of what we're looking for.
Leave it on that one, and I'll talk a little bit about, yeah. So these results are actually, I think, for me, being in digital marketing for the last 10 or 12 years with most of you, these are pretty incredible. So basically what this says is 85% of the people that start this engagement go through all the way to the end. And they spend an average of 45 seconds doing so. 52% of them actually, at the end of it, click through to either the site or Facebook, depending on what the call to action is. And then ultimately, we do a survey with a research partner afterwards to test lift an intent to watch or whatever metric our client picks against people that have been exposed to the campaign and have been exposed to the client. If you get an idea of 52% lift in intent to watch, those are pretty off the chart metrics. All of this is kind of based theoretically on a Harvard Business School or medical school study that was done a couple of years ago that basically said if you talk to people while they're very engaged in something, it resonates more, it engages them even more. And if you can get them actively involved in an activity, they remember it and it has a much deeper impact than if they just watch something or they just listen to something or they just see something. So if you put that in context against many of the other options we have for digital marketing, display, some of the rollover rich media, some of the other things, you start to see that when you add up the different components of this, it's a very powerful offering and it has those kind of results. And these results are more or less around our average for the thousands of campaigns we've run. So typically, some campaigns will do a lot better than that, a few won't do that good, but for the most part, those are the type of results you see with Social Vibe. As I talked about a little bit earlier, the reason we believe that that works so well is the combination of a network that really is built around engagement and passion points, the ad unit, which really gives you that unlimited flexibility. We've done geolocation, we've done augmented reality. You can really do anything you'd like in that, and you can do it with zero production costs. And then ultimately our placement. We speak to people at times they're open and willing to be spoke to. We ask them to opt in, and then you get, once they opt in, you're at 100% share of voice. I'd love to give 1,000% share of voice if I could figure that out. But you've got 100% share of voice. So we think that's a very compelling offer. And in fact, we think it's so compelling, we've worked with iMedia to put together an offer for fourth quarter buys. And I know this is a little salesy, so I apologize. Hopefully the Twitter feed won't blow up. But we are willing to bet on ourselves and we're willing to bet on you. So we're putting out a guarantee to people that have attended the conference here, and exclusive as a value add to the conference. If you do a campaign with us in the fourth quarter, we will guarantee results. We'll guarantee a 70% completion rate, although our average is over 80%, so we expect that to do very well, and we'll guarantee 45 seconds. Although our average is 60 seconds. So if there's anyone out there that's planning for the fourth quarter or would like to do a test and has a little bit of extra budget on a brand, we would love to work with you. And as we say, we guarantee results, we guarantee engagement, and we'll guarantee the KPIs that your clients desire. I think that's it, we're out.
Great, thank you guys, appreciate it. All right, Garth. From Curalate, coming in to close it up, the closer.
Thank you. That's right. So thank you for having me. I'm going to talk a little bit about images and how images are becoming the center of the social universe. I know a number of you. I built the business prior to Curalate that I've just joined. Recently, I built the business at Clout for the last 3 years, and I know quite a few of you from that experience. We're really happy to be here. We are a startup. We don't have any massive case studies to show with large brands. Just in the last 3 months, almost 1,000 brands, major brands, have signed up for Curalate, and they did it on their own. Without any promotion, very few people have ever heard of us, so we found that to be a phenomenon. And there's a reason why they're doing that. We created something really interesting, and that is the ability to measure and analyze images. And I'm going to focus mainly on Pinterest, which clearly is a force to be reckoned with today, but I'm really talking about images, images in general. People are more and more communicating in social with images, not with words. So we're going from tweets to images. We see Instagram and an explosion of adoption. And when we look at Pinterest, we see statistics like the fastest growing network, the network to gain 10 million users, fastest in history, incredibly passionate people pinning images without words, with no words, simply searching, finding things they like, pinning those to their boards, people seeing those that follow them. And Brian said something really interesting, which I think is the crux of this, which is they are doing it. Pinterest is not doing it. They're doing it. The brand is not doing it, right? So I just find it really an incredible world, an incredible universe that's sort of developing. A picture is worth 1,000 words. So I looked, I looked at the origin of that and sort of, a picture is worth 1,000 words. Yeah, that sort of makes sense. That's a journalistic phrase from 1911, 1912, in which newspapers figured out that a photo, I think what it really means is that you could not have enough words to describe this photo. You could not have enough words. It's not 1,000 words, it could be even 100,000 words wouldn't describe what's in this picture. And that's true. And why is that true? Why is a picture worth 100,000 words, 1,000 words? Because it's emotional. And why is the adoption of Pinterest so crazy, right? Why did it happen so fast? Why did Instagram, where, by the way, you actually don't know the other people who you're connected with, right? In Pinterest, very often you don't know the people that are following you, right? So you're talking now about networks as opposed to Facebook, where you really don't know the other people, where it's really image-based. It's really based on, I like that and so do I, and therefore I'm going to follow you, and here's an image that you can see, and we have this connection. So how can a brand leverage that? How can a brand leverage the move from text to images? The problem is that all of our technology is geared toward words still, right? It's in social, in analytics, in search, it's keywords, it's URLs. It's not based on images, right? Our technology is not based on measuring images. So actually what we need to do is we need to measure images. Curate, 7 guys in a small little place in Philadelphia have figured out how to do that. And the trick is not just measuring an image, all the pixels on an image, but tying that to its origin, not to the URL that it came from. 3,000 people might have pinned the same sweater. How do I distinguish those people if all I have is the URL? I can't, right? So tying that to the person and tracing it back to the person can be a very interesting thing for the brand. So we need to measure images, and we need to take a visual approach to analytics, not a word approach. And that's what Curate does. That's what we do. And then, of course, all networks are moving toward images. It's not just Instagram, and I'm not talking about video here. I'm not talking about YouTube and other video platforms. All networks are moving toward images. Facebook, with timeline, with cover photos, you can say is a move toward image. The rise of infographics is a move toward image, right? Why are tweets with a photo attached retweeted 12 times more than tweets without photos attached? There's a reason for that. Instagram, I think, is self-explanatory. I think so is Pinterest. There's some statistics, a lot of statistics about Pinterest. We know Pinterest is interesting. It's dominated by women. However, when I think about UFC and I think about Pinterest use, I don't necessarily think about female users. I see a lot of B2B applications now, so I think Pinterest is growing male. But I think the most interesting thing about Pinterest to me is that 90% of all the images that are pinned come from your website. And I think that's something that's something I don't really hear very much. So people going to your website, finding something they like, and pinning it to their board. So the center of the universe is not the fan page for these people. It's your website. But you don't know that they exist. So what I would encourage is for on the brand side is not to take a fan page approach to Pinterest. And you already see it happening. So people feel, well, I got to build boards for all my verticals. I'm a brand, so I have to build all these boards and I have to get people to follow me. So that's what they're doing. That's not where the action is. Where the action is on Pinterest is your customers and their boards, not your boards. I wouldn't spend a lot of time on your boards. I would actually try to find people who are pinning from your websites and populating their boards and sharing that content with their friends. How do you do that? Well, there's only one company I've ever seen, and that would take image analytics and image recognition software, and that's what Curate does. So I think it's really interesting. So 90% of all pins in Pinterest come from your website, but we don't know who those people are, and right, because we don't have any way to gather that information until now. Sorry, some of this is so new. I'm using notes, so forgive me. So if I pin something from J. Crew, you know, I like J. Crew, and I pin that sweater from J. Crew, what am I saying when I do that? I'm saying, I love this sweater. That's what I'm saying. I'm on J. Crew, I'm searching on their store, I pin that sweater, I'm saying, I love this sweater. I'm not saying I love the brand, because there aren't any words that go along with that in Pinterest. Right, there aren't any words in Pinterest to describe that. All I see is that sweater, right? So I'm saying I love that sweater. So what is Pinterest doing? What is happening with those people that are Pinterest users? They're going down to a very granular level that's about not about people and places so much. It's about things, and I will argue that 80 to 90% of those things are products. So it's about products. And that's the only network that I know that is like that, right? So it's taking this global like that I think people can be frustrated with, right? It's like, is that really engaging? To sort of reversing that and saying, these people have already said they love my product, but I don't know. Again, I don't know who they are, and I don't see them until now. So I'm not going to talk too much about analytics because I don't know that that's very interesting to people, except to say that we have figured it out. We figured it out. But however, if anybody, there are a handful of people that love analytics, and anybody that wants to talk about machine learning and image recognition and all of that stuff, we love to talk about that. I am not the best person to talk about that with, but we will go into that as deeply as you'd like. What if I told you that I could show you Avida, your top 1,000 pinners? What if I told you I could show you your top pinned product today? Your top pinned product. What if I told you I could show you the 1,000 pinners who are the most powerful, the most influential, and those people would be the ones who could drive the most repins, who could drive the most actions are repins in Pinterest, who could drive the most actions from your website, your product, on Pinterest. That would be a mind-blowing thing to see, because you can't see that now. Right, you have your own Pinterest boards, and people follow them, and you have, you know, that's it, that's all you have. But for those 800 brands that joined us in the last 3 months, they're looking at their top pinners, the top pin product every day, and the most powerful pinners. And those are just organic people out there who are doing it themselves. They're doing it themselves with no provocation, no promotion, nothing. They're simply fans, they're passionate, they love your product, and now we can gather that information and show it to you. The question is now, what do we do after that? How do we engage with those people? And that is really exciting. That's an exciting part. So for Aveda, for Kohl's, for Levi's, for Macy's, for Campbell's, for NBC, for Turner, for Oakley, Pepsi, all the brands that are here, I could show you that today. I can show you that today. It's exciting. And I'd like to show that to you. So what are the implications? I'm going to stop with the slides. The implications are pretty powerful. And we're just talking Pinterest. So now we're going to add Tumblr. We're going to add the fancy. We're going to add every site that is image-centric. And we're going to do the same thing in those networks, all the image-centric sites. So the implications are that you can optimize e-commerce. Why would you have the least pinned product or the number 254 pinned product, most pinned product, on your homepage if you could have the top pinned product on your homepage? I think you should have the top pinned product on your homepage. In the email that you send to customers, why would you have the 1,300th most pinned product, most popular product? Maybe you should put in the top pin product. And now you can do that. Now you could optimize based on all those millions of people pinning your product. You could optimize e-commerce. We're building an engagement platform, and I want to simply invite you to collaborate with us. We're funded, so we have the ability to do things. So I want to invite all the brands here to collaborate with us. A lot of which involves no money at all, and we'd like to come up with ways to engage. We are Pinterest experts. The only thing that I've seen is a Pinterest promotion called Pin It to Win It. I see that over and over again, great, but there are 30 other things that we could do to engage with those people, and we now have the ability to engage. Let's take the top 2,000 pinners of your product. We have the ability to engage with them. And so that's pretty exciting. So you can engage with them. We want you to engage with them. We can make all of your other marketing pinnable. We can make all of your emails pinnable. It's a weird concept, I know, but I can explain that more in detail. All of the marketing that you do, we can make it pinnable. So we've developed the technology to do that. So I want to invite all of you to collaborate with us. Create projects with us in the next 3 months, because that's where we're at. That's the stage we're at. Most of you, all the brands there, have already signed up for the analytics part, but not for the engagement part. And we'll come up with ways to engage, first of all, to show you those people, to show you the product that they like, that's your product, and then to engage with them. And I also just want to leave on one other note. At Clout, when I was at Clout, I created Clout for Good. And that became a big part of the company. If any of you have charities charities that are associated with your brands, I'd like to invite you to do the same thing at no cost and work with us on your charities in Pinterest campaigns, because we find that a very interesting area and a very interesting subject. And we'd be happy to run campaigns with you again with your most passionate pinning customers for your charities. So we would love to do that. Just come and see me, and we'll cook up something really fast. Thank you very much.
Well done. All right, terrific. I told you these guys were going to deliver. I have a couple comments, and then we're going to get you guys all to engage here and talk a little bit about some of the best engagements that you've seen. Obviously, we saw three great presentations that all have a different view of engagement. And I think that's the point, is that there's no one answer for one brand. There's probably multiple answers. If you look at the traditional funnel or consumer decision journey funnel, I think there's this concept of engagement at any one of those stages. And I think it's important as marketers that we figure out what the right type of engagement is at the right stage in each of those platforms, in each of those experiences. I think as we look at the term platform, and I'm not going to debate it with you today because there's a lot, that could be a whole session in itself. I think the idea is that there's lots of these amazing and emerging platforms that these guys have that are opportunities for us to take advantage of. I think the goal of the next session here is for all of us to take our collective brain power, share some of the best ones we've seen, whether it's your own brand's engagement or others that you've seen that you've liked that you thought was effective, maybe even share some best practices of things you didn't like that didn't work so that we can learn from each other. We're going to let you guys talk amongst yourselves at your table for the next 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
Five, 10 minutes,
there you go. And then we're going to go around and get some input from you all, so don't go anywhere. Thanks.
Thanks, Robert. Yeah, so exactly to Robert's point, we're now going to tabletop discussion, and we're going to talk about the types of innovative technologies that you guys are partnering with, that you're interested with, that are up and coming, et cetera. We're going to do this for about 5 minutes, so if you guys just want to start shouting out some company names, and then we will close the show. So we heard Instagram, we heard Tumblr. All right, Robert. Hey, Robert.
We might be deviating from.
You guys got a hot platform here?
Hey, Robert. go to Bev. I want to hear her story.
Let's talk to Bev.
You guys, we're gonna
we're going
quiet down for a second.
We're on the red carpet.
I think we've culled a couple new technologies and stories from the audience. We're just gonna hear from Beverly.
Shh.
It's difficult when I ask you to talk, then I ask you to be quiet. But Bev, stand up, please, and tell everyone where you're from. And it sounds like Robert heard some interesting innovations coming from the Grammys, which I'm not surprised.
I think what happened was Robert beat me. Like, I'm feeling abused right now. So my name is Beverly, and we did an interesting thing this year with our partners at Mass Relevance, because as Garth pointed out, visualization is extremely important. And for us, we can't take you away from the television. Ultimately, we want you to watch television. We want you glued to the chair with a bowl of popcorn watching the television. But we recognize that people don't always do that, and that's not where all of our younger viewers are. So in order to get them engaged, we created a second screen experience and created visualizations with Mass Relevance. So we used a company called People Browser to help us figure out, and you know them from Cred, they're the Cred team. We helped them figure out who the influencers were. We tapped into those influencers, leveraged visualizations on the second screen experience that we created internally. It was proprietary creation with CBS. And we created an experience where fans could actually walk down the red carpet. Artists could walk down the red carpet, fans could talk to them in real time, and others could see the question, and that would all be sort of curated on one screen in one experience. And that became extremely independent of the fact that we were the most social event in the history of television, drove 13 million social medias across Facebook, Twitter, and blogs, and second highest ratings since 1984, we had Whitney Houston die in the middle of the entire weekend. So that experience was also sort of a crisis management experience. On Saturday night, while her body was being removed from the building, we were doing our pre-Grammy gala. So we had that entire experience. All of that was first happening on our second screen experience and created through the visualizations that Mass Relevance drove.
So Beverly, you said Mass Relevance, and then you also mentioned People Browser.
People Browser for their Cred property.
Okay, does anybody else want to talk about an up-and-coming company or a new technology that they're using to achieve goals or are interested in exploring? Everybody got shy at the end of the day.
Well, we had an interesting question over here for Curalate.
We went down a little bit of a rabbit hole, and we're talking specifically about Curalate and what the possibilities are, and it ended up for us being a question of electronic intelligence. If you can tell me what my best sellers are, can I come to you and figure out what all my competitors' best sellers are if I need to?
Yes.
We'll be talking. Okay.
Yes.
That was great.
Yes. I could take any brand in the world and I could look in 10 seconds and tell them who their top 1,000, 10,000 pinners are and what their top product is being pinned currently, which is an understatement to say that is exciting to us.
Exciting to us, too.